Oops. Hello, welcome to the This Charming
Smithscast.
Dang it! We finally figured it out. That's gonna be the name. We are the Handsome Hooligans.
Yeah.
You like that? Actually, we did get a comment in Facebook, so.
So it was
from my brother, and he said something about the Sweet and Tender Hooligans or something. So I was like, okay, well, we're going to take part of that. So that was our...
Yeah.
So we're the Handsome Hooligans. The other comment was, you guys suck, and that was by my wife, so...
Yeah.
We decided not to use that one.
That's in parentheses. Like.
Yeah. Handsome Hooligans, you guys suck.
So, and I'm Mark, again.
I'm Kazmir.
And I'm Steven.
And we're going to be today talking, jumping right into...
The Smiths'
first album, so...
The first album.
But before we do that, there's something that needs to be addressed. It's been on everybody's mind. Weird Al Yankovic in 3D. I did actually check, and it was Eat It that was the main track. And actually, it's a really good album.
Yeah.
But it was 1984 that I bought it, so I was nine years old. So I was a young guy, but it had the Brady Bunch, you know, that did that.
What was the polka on that one?
Polka on 45.
Man, are you guys excited for this Weird Al Yankovic podcast?
Anyway, so I'm just saying I just want to put that out there. I know it's on everybody's mind. They've been tweeting about it.
Yeah.
Actually, we have 76 views on our thing. Kaz hasn't even watched it, but that's okay.
Yeah, yeah. No, I want to keep it pure.
Ooh.
Yeah,
he doesn't want it. And that's admirable of you.
So. Yeah.
No, it isn't.
Yeah, we need more views, dude.
You're not going to watch it, man. Why is anybody else going to watch it?
You know, John Williams does that, the composer. He hasn't seen any of the films he's composed for.
Actually, that's not true. He's actually seen all of them.
You gotta...
Because when he does the orchestra, they're actually playing the scenes in the background.
Oh, but he hasn't seen any complete.
Yeah, he hasn't seen it complete, but that's the way they record it. They have the big old scene in the background, so the conductor can actually get the right emphasis at the right time based on what's going on.
So all right.
I can match it up. So.
Well, there we go. Well, so anyway... It's Weird Al Yankovic's second album is good.
Second, yeah.
But let's talk about the Smiths' first album.
So the Smiths' first album. So the Smiths came around.
That's very funny.
So really quick, the Smiths came around because a boy by the name of Johnny Marr decided he wanted to be in a band, and all the other places he had been was, you know, substandard. It wasn't really going anywhere. And one of his friends said, hey, let's go talk to this guy, Stephen Morrissey. And they showed up on his doorstep one day and said, hey, let's form a band. Morrissey looks at him and says, okay, come on in.
Basically.
So, and that's when it started. Then they said, let's create a band.
I love all the little details in that story, like Johnny Marr recounting just how long it took Morrissey to get down the stairs and
open
it. Yeah, he knocks on the door.
They're waiting.
And then they're waiting, and then they decide to knock again. And then his sister answers.
Yeah.
And says, I'll get him. And then, you know, because, yeah.
Yeah.
I just refreshed my memory on that whole thing. Listened to it on Thursday, so.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there was an old rumor that Johnny Marr had eaten a chocolate bar, and, like, he put his hand on the door sill, or the door, you know, and, like, there was a chocolate stand. Anyway.
So,
but that's just a rumor.
Yeah, so they created the group, and what was the first song they worked on together?
The first song they worked on together?
Oh, yeah. Well, Suffer... No, not Suffer a Little... Yeah,
nope.
Wait, no, no, no.
Nope.
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle. No. Dang it, man!
It was... the first song that they worked on together was, like, a Western, like...
Yeah, no, it was Don't Blow Your Own Horn.
Oh, yeah!
And it was just like what Mark said about some of the other songs. is like if somebody gave Mark some music and said, hey, create the lyrics for this, that's what he would do, and that's the way Morrissey and Marr felt about that first song, and they just said, let's just scrap this crap. And so they scrapped it, and they started working on...
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle.
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle.
And then...
Which was really what?
Kimberly.
Oh, yeah. The Cash pointed this out after the last one. Yeah. Well, not a ripoff, just a...
Oh,
I mean, all music's a ripoff, though.
Homage.
I mean, I'm saying... Anyway.
Yeah, I mean, Panic. That's the most obvious...
It's okay, listen. Everybody rips off everybody else, and it's fine. KMFDM is no more than a ripoff of Captain and Tennille.
I've never heard any Captain and Tennille songs like that.
Okay, Mark, do you
want to
start a podcast that's not this one?
That's not. Wait. KMFDM, Captain and Tennille. Like, yeah, they're a total ripoff of that. Anyway, so. But let's get into the album.
Okay,
let's just start off with the first track. Do you just want to jump into it, or do you want to...
Well, okay, so let's talk about a little bit about how they got there.
Okay, with Hand and Glove.
Yeah, so
the first single that
they create. So they had some demo discs, and Rough Trade heard them and signed them to a one single deal. For Hand and Glove,
mm-hmm.
They put it out there, and it was really popular in the UK underground scene. So that's when Rough Trade.
Yeah, never charted, but.
Yeah, it never charted, but it was big enough because that's where Rough Trade was.
Yeah.
That was their area. They were never going to compete with something like EMI.
Oh. Yeah, because
they went to EMI first.
Well, yeah, actually, yeah, they knew somebody that worked at EMI,
yeah.
And. But
at that time, you did not want to sign to EMI because the EMI refused to let the Sex Pistols stay on, and so it was very taboo to sign to EMI. Everybody just went to EMI so that...
Is that what that song, that EMI song by the Sex Pistols is about?
Yeah.
EMI. And they also turned down Factory Records because Factory Records wanted to sign them.
No, Factory Records didn't want to sign them.
I thought they turned them down.
Factory Records turned them down, but Johnny Marr was like, well, I wouldn't want to go with him anyway.
So. Oh, okay. So I got it turned around.
But, what was it? Oh, man. No, I'm looking at my... Oh, I was going to play a thing for... Oh, I had something in my notes because I...
Okay, so...
So, anyway...
Factory turns them down. Rough Trade is done.
So I cannot sing, by the
way. Rough Trade signs them to a one single deal. They put it out, and it goes big.
Wouldn't it be a single deal?
It was.
Oh, I'll start my own podcast.
He's like, I'm out of here. But this is one, just a tidbit. Their first gig was on the 4th of October, 1982.
The 4th of October?
Yeah. And then their first single, so that was only, came out on the 14th of May, 1983, and they'd only played like a couple gigs.
Yes.
So there's not a big span of time.
So real quick, we're not going to get into this.
Let's just get on the album.
We're not going to get into this. So Rough Trade signs into a full album. They bring in Troy Tate to do it. And
he's doing it.
No, listen.
Sounds like you're getting into it, dude.
No. So they bring it in. Troy Tate does his own version of the songs. And for whatever reason, which is still in dispute by the Handsome Hooligans.
That's right.
They bring in John Porter. John Porter says, we need to re-record everything. But the Smiths were in the process of touring at the time, so they had to record it in bits and pieces. They couldn't record the whole album at the same time. So that is how we get the Smiths. But there's also another bootleg out there with just the Troy Tate sessions.
Yeah, we talked about last time, and we have
and
it.
That's where the Troy Tate sessions come from, is the first recording of the Smiths' first album.
So we're going to get into the album proper that's out there that we all know and love.
Which, by the way, is one of the best albums.
What, of the Smiths' albums?
Yeah.
okay. It's my least favorite album of the Smiths albums.
Yeah.
Actually.
The debut? Yeah.
I think, okay. I mean, I'm not, it's a Smiths, it's a good album. I'm not downgrading it in any way.
You have to listen to the composition of the music.
Well, I know, but I think, for me, the recording and stuff, is the problem. It's not properly mixed or recorded.
Yeah.
It just seems
okay,
like
and
sometimes the guitar end up, but you get to the second side. Anyway, well, let's just take
okay,
the first song, take it as it goes.
What's the first song, then?
First song is Reel Around the Fountain.
Reel Around the Fountain.
Which is Mike Joyce's debut. He's the one that actually, like we talked about, the 25%, he earns it in this song. I mean, the first thing you hear is Mike Joyce.
Okay, but another thing. Going on to what you were saying, it wasn't the best mixed or recorded album, and the reason being is because, again, they first went with Troy Tate, spent a lot of money that way, then they had to spend a lot of money to re-record everything.
Well,
and they didn't have enough money to finish it up the way that it should have been.
Yeah, and that was always my problem. And it's slower, because you get a, anyway, it's slower than it's a slow start. So let's just get on.
So Reel Around the Fountain.
Okay, so there he is.
There's his 25%.
It's time to tell what's told.
Okay. We can only do so much, but then there's a part I want to jump to.
Okay.
So
first off, just so the 70-some-odd people who are watching this podcast, actually the two people that watch it, you know, 70 times.
No, because I was logged in as the administrator, so all the times I watched it didn't even count.
Okay. So anyway, we're not going to go over what the songs actually mean. We're not going to discuss that. We're going to discuss what they mean to us.
We can talk about the lyric. Yeah, what they mean to us, what they mean to...
Yeah,
actually, the more I listen to this, and I've listened to this album a lot over the last couple weeks, I mean, so much so that...
Yeah.
That I realized I always had my own interpretation of the lyrics.
Yeah.
Or the songs. But actually, whenever Morrissey was saying something totally different, I always had like these fantasies about.
Yeah. So, and that's we're not going to second guess what Morrissey was thinking or what Mara was thinking. We're just going to discuss what we think about the songs, what they mean to us, and our opinions on the song.
Okay. Well, this is okay. Do you guys? I got some notes that I wrote down as I had some insight. I was like, oh my gosh, that's what they were talking about.
So let's first start with Kaz. Kazmir, what do you think about Reel Around the Fountain?
I really like Reel Around the Fountain, actually. But one of the things that I think is like super present in Reel Around the Fountain that I think is really present in all of the Smiths' first album is that Morrissey wasn't writing lyrics like for a full song. I felt like he was writing tidbits that he liked and then weaving them together. Like, the part when he's singing, I can't even remember anything. Oh, I've got this handy dandy lyrics book.
Handy.
Oh, yeah. I wonder who gave that to me. When he's going on, I dreamt about you last night and I fell out of bed twice. That's a line straight from A Taste of Honey. And I feel
I've
like...
I've never seen that. Is that good movie?
It's all right. It's one of Morrissey's favorites.
Boy, yeah, obviously. He's...
Yeah.
But then,
yeah.
Okay. Well, so you say you don't think that fits into the song, or
no?
Well,
I think it fits. I'm just saying, like at this time, Morrissey, I don't think Morrissey was writing like full songs all at once. I think he was taking like little verses, like parts that he had and weaving them together.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And I can see that too. It was like he was writing non sequiturs, or
like his novel.
Yeah. And so then he would just piece them together and basically try to make a full song on that. And a lot of times it worked beautifully. Some of the times, not so much.
Okay, well, the song... Okay, so...
So
I saw it somewhere, you know, where there it's about an older woman. And basically, I mean, I remember when I was a kid and I had, you know, there's somebody like an older... a woman that you thought was so pretty and stuff, or me, I thought so pretty.
You thought you were so pretty?
I was a pretty, pretty princess. But
Mark was pretty. He stole my girlfriend twice. Twice he stole my girlfriend.
Oh, now, okay, this is a Smith's podcast. We don't need to get into that. We
talk. Exactly.
Oh, man.
Whoa, that run deep.
Jealousy isn't part of a Smith's podcast?
No, that's the Gin Blossoms.
Oh, I see.
Podcast. He's jealousy.
Yeah.
But, okay, so I was like, whenever I used to listen to it, I'd be like, oh, yeah, if I could just spend some time with this person and, you know, but I didn't realize 15 minutes. Well, 15 minutes, anyway, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
15 minutes is the standard time that it takes, you know, to...
to copulate.
Excuse me!
Okay.
This is a family... No, but yeah, so anyway, but I was always like, oh, if I could just spend 15 minutes with, you know, this person, you know, I think she'd like me, you know, and... But, okay, but it's, I don't know what I'm, it's about an older woman.
Yes.
Okay, you take over, because I'm going to,
When I was a kid, I didn't like girls the same age as me. I actually was more attracted to older women. And not just older women, but older women. Like, when I was 18, 19 years old, my ideal woman was about 40, 45. I really liked older women. I thought they had more beauty to them than 20-year-olds running around scantily clad. And so this song, what? Why are you laughing?
I don't know.
Exactly. Another wound. My heart. So anyway, when I listen to this song, that's what I think of is a young boy who is enthralled with an older lady that has some kind of power over him, whether it's a school teacher,
yeah.
Whether it's a...
That's what I'm saying. Is this, I mean, if you've ever had a crush on, you know, like an older, when you're a kid, you know, a teacher or something, like, oh, she's really pretty. I mean, it's not necessarily anything... you know, sexual or anything. But the funny thing is in the song and where it talks about it is,
you can pin out me like a butterfly.
Oh yeah. That's from the, what's that show? The collector. Terrence Stamp.
Oh.
Where he's got a butterfly collection and but he collects women too and kills them.
Yes. That was also a Simpsons episode, Halloween special.
Oh, really?
Yeah, The Collector. Don't you remember Bart and Lisa Bart and Lisa get superpowers?
No.
And then Xena comes and rescues them. And then Xena starts flying. And then Lisa says, hey, wait, I didn't think Xena flew. And she said, I'm not Xena, I'm Lucy Lawless. And all of a sudden, that was okay. Because Lucy Lawless can fly for some reason.
Well, so... you know, even in his dreams, though, he can't have... She won't even take him to the heaven of her bed. Because even in his dreams. He's so hopeless.
Okay,
you know,
so,
it's never going to happen.
But this is what I thought, is that it was a male student, female teacher.
Yeah.
But we're assuming it's a male student and a female teacher.
That's from my point of view.
It's entirely possible it could be male student, male teacher. Because
words. It could be a...
Pin and mount me?
Oh, Steve, you're not going to... Don't go there.
No, and I'm not trying to make this dirty, but just the way words are.
Okay. All right.
So that's why I say it. But for me, I've never felt it that direction. I've always felt it more...
Yeah, I never thought about that. Now you're making it so dirty.
I'm not trying to make it dirty.
I'm just joking.
the Smith's first album is dirty and super sexualized?
I know, actually, you realize, the more you listen to it, you're like, wait, actually, it is.
Like,
but okay, so
like
the song goes on for the first 3.5 minutes, doing the same thing. You know, but then there's this one part... I wish they would have just kind of cut it down. It's just, You know, there's the part where it goes into a different verse. Oh, here it is.
I don't mind the piano there.
No, I love the piano. No, this version of Reel Around the Fountain, because there's the one on Hatful. I love this one. Yeah. I love the organ in it. I love, you know, the piano in it. But I'm saying, like, it goes for almost 4 minutes with just the same thing, and then all of a sudden it does that little change up.
Yeah.
You know, where it has this little extra verse or whatever, and the little piano comes in, and yeah. I love that part. But I think overall the song's a little bit too long for me, for my taste.
Can I kind of come in with
a
swayed fact?
No.
Hey, with what?
A swayed fact.
Okay,
a swayed fact, yeah.
I think it really shows how much of...
I mean, I came in with the Weird Al facts.
So. Yeah,
believe me, you can.
I think it really shows how much Bernard Butler, who was like the music man and guitarist in Suede for the early years, how much he really loved Johnny Marr, because the first song on their first album starts off with drums and then piano in the middle. So,
really?
Yeah. I think it's just very funny how much of a Smiths geek he is.
Oops. I'm sorry, I'm knocking the table. So if you just saw that jiggle right there, that was...
Earthquake!
Yeah.
My gosh.
I will stop doing that.
Okay.
Back to the Smiths.
So, okay, there we are with the first song. Not my favorite, but it's one that I was able to relate to, and that also I would relate it to my dating life. I'm like, oh man, if somebody would just spend some time with me, you know, she realize I'm a good guy.
Yeah.
Anything. You know, 15 minutes, that's all. I know, but I was always kind of a shy,
desperation.
Dumb.
Yeah. Oh, you weren't.
Oh, I was. You know, whenever I liked somebody, I was.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah. Anyway,
it
would be. I don't know. Yeah. Anyway, I was.
All right.
But I was. Okay.
Actually, yeah.
Let's go on
to the next one. Because there was a girl. Okay, listen.
Yeah.
There was a girl he actually liked.
Dang. Okay.
And he would not call her, but I had to call her for him.
Okay. I know. That's what I'm saying. So.
And then she wasn't available to do it. And the funny thing is he says, "What about her younger sister?"
Oh gosh.
Lawrence, if she's
oh man, that's funny. Yeah.
I'm like, okay, that's true story.
Okay, so now we've...
But you've got everything now.
Yeah. Okay, so we come on.
Should we play the beginning of that?
Yeah.
As merry as the days were long, I was writing you a...
All right. So, yeah, we're in 14 seconds.
Yeah.
Hey, go ahead, Cash. Lead us off.
First things first. The Hatful Apollo version is better. It's just so much better. I really also like this one live. This one is really cool from all the videos I've seen of it. When it's played in concert.
Well, but this finally takes that. After 6 minutes of Reel Around the Fountain, suddenly got a little energy to it. But it's still, you know, It's a good one. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know. I don't really have funny fact that I realized. Okay, so the lyrics are, you know, I want to be seen in the back of your car. I don't want a girlfriend, you know, but I want people to think that me and you are together, you know, because I don't, maybe he was getting picked on or something, or he just wanted to, right? I mean,
he just wanted to be a trophy.
That's what I'm saying. He just like, hey, I don't want a girlfriend. I don't want this. Let's just kind of like, remember, what's that movie?
Can't Buy Me Love.
Yeah. That's the one. You want to rent me? Like, basically, yeah, Morrissey was buying a telescope.
Yeah.
He saw the girl with the...
He saw the awesome girl who was having a problem because she spilled some wine on her mother's light.
And he happened to have that $2,000.
No, guys, this is a Smiths, not Pulp. Come on.
Anyway, that's funny.
That was a good
But no, that's basically, he's like, hey, I just need... yeah, trophy girlfriend. I don't want to do anything that we, you know, I just want to be seen in the back of your car. And I, but the very last line, he's like, I just want to be tied to, you know, to the back of your car. I didn't realize till this last week, because I always pictured him actually tied with rope onto the trunk of the car. Like, that was just, because tied. And I was like, wait a second, tied? He's not saying tied to the back of your car, like literally tied to the back of your car. He's saying, like if you're tied to a crime or something, like, kind of like seen.
Associated.
Wait, did you think he was actually tied with rope
too?
Yeah,
no, I thought he was being kinky.
Me too, man.
No, I didn't think
I'm not kinky, but I was just like, he was like tied to the trunk.
Yeah, I thought it was more like a trophy buck. You go out hunting and you catch him. You latch him up to the back of your car.
Yeah, but I doubt that in Manchester they had a lot of hunting trophy bucks.
Yeah, they did.
No, they did, but instead
they were hunting werewolves.
No, they were hunting just like big piles of coal. That's what
I'm saying. So I think he meant tied in the way associated with the back of his, but and not the actual literal tied that I was taking it as. So that's like one insight I had as I was going on. I got like, but this one kind of picks up picks up the beat. And then the next song, do you just want to move on to the next song?
Yeah, I actually want to add something.
Okay.
To me, I always thought this song was about, like, jealousy and, like...
Yeah.
How are these people getting so ahead in life when they're just, like, the worst and the dumbest people I've ever met? Like, I think it's very much a callback to his school days. But you've got everything now, and what a terrible mess I've made of my life.
And again, we got to look at our viewpoints. I mean, Kaz is still, you know, he's a senior.
Yeah.
He would be a senior in high school. But, you know, when Mark and I were in high school, and even junior high listening to this, it was a lot different for us because... For those of you who don't know, Mark was a lot cooler than I was, and I grew up my younger life in a small Nebraska town.
Yeah, but look at you now.
But listen,
you got everything.
But look, where I grew up and where I went to high school and even junior high, you could have called it John Hughes High School because it's exactly like the John Hughes films.
There's a nerd.
Yeah, you had your different groups, and you didn't go to the different groups. If you were a member of the jock group, you didn't associate with anybody.
Oh, that was a nice thing about Chandler High, though.
Yeah, and so Mark didn't grow up in that kind of environment.
Yeah.
And so when my family moved to Arizona, it was a really hard thing for me to accept because I was never a member of these other cliques. And all of a sudden, I see everybody mixing and matching, and it's like, whoa, that's kind of odd. That's weird. Because where I grew up, I tried to play football, and I was pretty dang good at it, but I was not considered a jock because I was a skinny kid. I didn't come from the right area of town, and my dad didn't work at the right place, and I didn't have the best clothes.
You got the best clothes.
And so the thing is
the best clothes.
So the jocks never accepted me, and they always tried to get me off of the team. And I couldn't go with the preps because the preps didn't like me either. And I wasn't necessarily a, you know, a quote-unquote nerd.
Okay, so
but,
I'm saying, okay, so you're saying, so...
So reel around the fountain to me.
No, you've got everything now.
Sorry, you've got to...
He's imposter.
Listen, I'm dealing with...
He's never heard this album.
We're on Miserable Lie, right?
Yeah.
No, but I'm saying, so
okay,
what are you...
So you've got everything now. To me, when I listened to it, it was a lot more, like what you were saying, that the tie to your car associated with the car. And in my high school, before I moved to Arizona, it was very much who you were seen with and who you were associated with. And I couldn't... There was a wonderful, wonderful young lady that I thought was very, very beautiful. And I'm not going to give her name just because.
Yeah.
And And she was
unless
always,
she has a lot of followers, maybe she can.
No, she was always very, very nice to me, and she was always very open with me, mm-hmm. and I actually liked her, but she couldn't necessarily really talk to me when everybody else was there because it was a bad thing to be seen talking to somebody in my cast. Because, and when I say cast, I mean like the cast system, like the class.
Yeah, oh, I think you meant you're in a giant body cast.
No. So
being tied
the
to
thing
the
is you couldn't mix and match because if you were, then all of a sudden it was like, oh, look, somebody's slumming over there, and you couldn't really do that. And so when I listen to this, that's exactly what I think about is somebody who just wants to feel... Well, you know, they want a belonging type of feeling. They want to belong to somebody, to something better, and not saying that their current group is bad, but it's just like there's so much more to life than just this. And
well, I know, but he's saying like, hey, we're on a long time.
Yeah,
but he's saying like, I used to win in high school. You know, I used to do all this stuff. Now I'm. You've got everything.
Yeah, see, I didn't ever take it that way. I've always... So, like, the back at the old gray school, I would win and you would lose. So, the other thing about this, and again, Mark can't really understand this because he didn't grow up in this kind of environment, but in elementary school, everybody was friends. One of my best friends...
What do you mean? We're all friends in elementary school. How couldn't I understand that?
So we were all friends in elementary school, and there was this one kid that he was my best friend. And we would always, you know, be around each other. And it changed the first day of junior high.
Oh.
It changed because he realized he was on the right side of town, and I wasn't.
Okay.
And so all of a sudden, my best friend was no longer my best friend because he knew that his status was above mine.
It is like a John Hughes movie.
It is.
I never really had that. So that sucks. So I couldn't relate to that.
So when I listen to that first line, that's exactly what I'm thinking about. When we were in elementary school, we were all friends, and even though I was, you know, we all had fun, and I was succeeding, and you weren't really succeeding, then we get to the next stage, and all of a sudden, you have everything now, and I don't have anything, and it's. Like one of the things people used to make fun of me for, and I'm not kidding, I got bullied hard for this, was the house that I lived in, the paint was chipping off of the house. That's what I got bullied for.
Yeah.
So it's like, I can't control that. What do you want me to do? You know, repaint my whole house by myself?
Yeah. people are stupid. That's just
yeah, and so that's why I see it more of that way, trying to move up in the class system and move up in your station in life. And one of the ways to do it in those types of areas was
paint your house.
If I would have just painted my house, to another part of town.
Oh, speaking about being on the wrong side of town, let's move into Miserable Lie.
Miserable Lie?
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
Miserable Lie.
Okay, so you got a slow start.
I love this song.
So you got that for the introduction, and then okay, so it's the slow introduction, and then all of a sudden.
I know
yeah.
Okay, so funny backstory about this. Again, talking about Nebraska. So we used to have these school dances, right? They would have DJs and everything. I took this album my sophomore year, and everybody was all.
Wait a second, you okay? This is gonna be a good story, something.
Yeah, no, because in Nebraska, everything was like either heavy metal or country music, and so I was an outcast. But the only time I could get any song that I liked played was a slow song. So, so I said, "Can we play this song?" And so the DJ listened to the first couple of frames of it. And he's like, yeah, I'll play it on the next slow song.
Oh.
And so they played a slow song, and then they played Miserable Lie, and I'm just sitting there dancing, watching it. watching everybody dance, and they're all like, oh, let's dance.
And all of a sudden, it goes really fast, and the DJ's like, what the hell? He turns it off right away, and I'm like, ah!
That's funny.
Yeah.
So. The perfect prank song.
Yeah, no. So, Mark, how about you start?
Well, I mean, I don't know. This is probably one of my least favorite songs on there, but...
Let's end the Smithscast with this. So once we're done with this, we gotta close up.
Okay, and then we'll start another part too. Yeah, because we don't want to go too long. I mean, 40 some minutes is a long time. Okay, so I like it. I think like Morrissey's problem with the whole album was the recording. I think the drums are. Throughout the whole album, kind of tinny and not good.
Yeah.
So you don't get the, you know, it doesn't make you, it just doesn't, I mean, it's like a good punk beat and stuff, but it just doesn't, I think it's just lost in the recording. And that they have the guitars so low.
Yeah.
So, not so low, but so, you know, turned down so low.
Yeah.
Like Johnny Mars, that, you know, you don't hear the really, you know, as much as you should. It's just the mix. It's a good song, but and then he goes a little long at the end with the.
I can't do it.
Yeah, I need advice. Yeah,
that'll
it's falsetto.
My
throat.
Yeah. I can do falsetto at times.
Yeah,
but
yeah, no, but I agree with you. Like, I don't necessarily think of John Porter being a great producer for this album. He does, like, hits really well. Like, he recorded this Charming Man, and he recorded Panic and Ask, and all those.
And he did Half Full of Hollow.
Yeah.
Well,
Half Full of Hollow is just a
conglomeration. Well, they have...
So,
yeah.
I think John Porter was very instrumental in the Smiths at this point in time, not necessarily for producing the album, but teaching Johnny Marr how to produce and how to just, like, overlay tons and tons of guitars.
That's true, yeah. That's one thing Johnny talked about in his book was, him and Porter spent a lot of time together, and actually the rest of the band was kind of, like, felt neglected, you know? But he's like, well, we got to go in the studio and mix this stuff up. You know, you guys just come in, do your drums, do your bass, to your voice, but then I got to layer this stuff, so I'm spending more time with John. You know, maybe jealousy was a part that played a part into that.
Oh yeah,
hey jealousy, but this isn't the the Gin Blossoms.
Episode 2 of the Gin Blossoms.
All right, so
Steve, what's your? Do you have any opinion about this specific song?
I like it.
There you go. But it's not, for me, it's just not my favorite song on there.
I can
take it or leave it.
I like it, and I think you saw my record once, because I had a bootleg record of one of their concerts. And the people putting together the bootleg record didn't know what to name this song, so they called it I Need Advice.
Yeah! Actually, that's the first time I realized what he was actually saying was when I heard it in a live version. Because I was like, I thought he was saying, like, my little voice, or whatever. I don't know.
My higher voice.
It's like a little, you know.
Yeah. No, Marcy's falsetto is very fun at the start.
Oh, yeah.
Like, early versions of What Difference Does It Make don't say, and my sacred one, they say, and my sacred mother.
They do?
Yeah.
Really? Well, okay, so we're going to end this part of it, and we're going to, I need a drink, and we'll do a part 2.
I told you to get a drink.
No, I just finished my drink. I'm going to get another one.
Another drink?
Ooh, are you sure you're ready for that?
Okay, what kind of drinking problem do you have? Do you have a drinking problem as in Pulp Fiction, or a drinking problem as in Airplane?
The only time I have a drinking problem is when I spill it.
No, haven't you ever seen Airplane? I have a drinking problem and he can't get the cup to his mouth. He always just like...
No, I'm just going to get some Diet Dr. Pepper.
So...
All right, so stay tuned.
So
we might switch it up a little bit, but we'll talk about it.
We might switch it up, but if you have any questions for us, put them in the comments.
or any comments about.
If you have any comments about us, put it in questions.
Yeah, because last time nobody commented on the YouTube.
I was going to comment on the YouTube one, but then I just.
You don't want
to
comment on your own thing.
I wasn't interested in this podcast. This podcast kind of sucks.
What do you mean? I watched it.
Yeah.
I seriously watched
it.
I watched it like 15 times.
I watched it 30 times, and every time I was like, I'm wasting my time.
No, I was laughing. Man.
I'm kidding.
I was like, actually laughed
literally,
out loud.
Literally, we will appreciate any comments, even if it is just spam of you are gay. And that's you.
Okay. On that note, just spam that for us.
Uruguay?
Yeah. Uruguay. Uruguay. Hey, what's wrong with Uruguay, man? You have a problem with that? He's racist. Or countryist.
He's
okay.
Countryist.
All right.
Yeah, let's,
wait. No, not yet.
What? Oh, I'm Mark. Oh, thanks for joining us on this
episode two. Part one of the Smiths' self-titled album.
Thanks for joining us for this charming podcast.
This is
Smithscast.
This is worse than how they did Sylvester Stallone.
Rocky?
No, not Rocky. The
Rambo?
Yeah, Rambo. This is the worst. Oh, man. Never mind. This is just terrible. All right.
Why? What's the matter with Rambo? Wait a second.
All right.
We can't end this one while you're back.
Do you want a subtitle? Charming podcast.
First Blood. Yeah.
Part two.
Is
that what you're talking about?
Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Rambo, First Blood, Part 2, Rambo, Rambo 3. Right?
No, it was Rambo 2.
No, it's First Blood, Part 2, Rambo.
First Blood, Part... Yeah, First Blood. Anyway, we'll... Okay, let's just...
I
still want to know what you have against Rambo movies.
I don't have anything against Rambo movies except that they're titled stupidly.
That's it. You're not my kid anymore.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, time for a drink on that note. All right.
Cass, come on, man.
I'm Cass.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey, play some music.
Oh. On the way out? Well.
Man.
See, we might want to. All right. Well, let's stop recording so we can record. But maybe we should just do.